I work on appearance modeling, and that basically involves understanding the way that the objects in our world look like, and that's related to how they react when they're illuminated by light.
This is Wenzel Jakob, an assistant professor of the IC School at EPFL.
So, for instance, you know, why does a piece of metal look different than something that's made out of marble or human skin? All of that essentially boils down to what happens in the moment that it's illuminated by light. Does it enter the object and then kind of bounce around inside and leave somewhere else, or is something else happening? And that involves essentially taking objects, thinking about them physically, but then also taking these physical concepts and mapping them into equations eventually that can be implemented and simulated on a computer.
But how hard can appearance modeling be?
Things get especially tricky when we're trying to render things that are organic. And the hardest is to do that for humans. And part of the reason is that being humans, well, we're very trained at looking at other humans and recognizing if they look like humans. And so we're very critical observers of that. So when you try and render, say, a human face and you don't get all of these physical effects right, then the effect is actually quite scary.
In fact, getting the appearance modeling of human body parts right is one of the most important and most challenging aspects of computer graphics.
So there is something that people refer to as the Uncanny Valley. And roughly the idea is that as you try and get closer and closer to a perfectly human depiction of a human, sort of the, let's say one extreme is very unrealistic, kind of comic style. It's more of a depiction of the idea of a person. And then on the other side, you really have a person that's rendered in perfectly accurate detail. And as you move from one to the other, the perceived amount of realism goes up and up and up. And just before you reach the other end, there's this tremendous valley where now suddenly things become very unrealistic and almost scary. So there's this kind of, I guess that's when people look a little bit like zombies. So they're almost human, but something is a little bit wrong, and we're very good at picking up on that.
And the reason why bridging the uncanny valley is so tricky is that some parts of the human body have particularly sophisticated interactions with light.
One example of that, for instance, is human hair. That's something that we might not think about very much, but physical effects here are quite intricate. So light will generally arrive on the hair on the outside. And I guess if you want to think of them that way, our hairs, they're a little bit like tiny glass cylinders. So not quite as brittle, but they have an index of refraction that's different from the air. And so what happens is that light refracts into a hair fiber, and then it might even bounce around a few times inside the hair fiber before it goes out on the other side. Obviously, the longer the time it spends inside the hair fiber, the more colored it becomes. And so then light will go into the next hair and so on. And so that might happen 100 times or so before it leaves at a completely different place. And so if you don't account for these simulations and you are rendering, say, a human character that has hair, then it'll look unrealistic, plasticky, sort of. And so, as I mentioned before, we're very good at picking up these sorts of things. So it's really important to account for that.
In fact, this is still an oversimplification of how human hair interacts with light.
To render hair well, you even need to account for subtle effects that it's not a perfect cylinder, but it's a little bit elliptical, and it has these scales that are tilted relative to the base surface. So all of these things in the end show up really in when you render hair. If you don't account for them, there's going to be a difference and it won't look right.
I bet you've never thought of that. Creating realistic computer-generated humans is so tricky, partly because our hair interacts with light in a highly non-trivial manner, and as well because the geometry of our hair is so complicated.
One interesting tidbit here is that blonde hair is particularly hard because blonde hair, it doesn't have a lot of absorption. So that means that light can potentially do very many bounces before it leaves. That makes it harder to render than, say, Asian hair.
So if the future Walt Disney heroes are all Asian, it might not be because I paid them to do so. It would rather be because rendering images of non-Asian hair requires too much computation time and power. But why is it so computationally costly to render the appearance of different materials?
Let's say you have a metal surface, and that's perfectly polished, just a mirror. The way that a mirror reflects light is very easy to understand. Light comes in at a certain angle, and then it just gets reflected at that same angle on the other side. So that's fairly simple. But now imagine that your mirror is not perfectly flat, but it's actually on some more intricate object that has a surface that has undulations or is maybe even a little bit wrinkled or something like that. Then, imagine taking a light source and illuminating that object. It will create these interesting patterns because light will be reflected by this object, but it's going to be reflecting more light into certain directions than in others. And that depends precisely on what the surface of this object looks like. So it's easy to say, oh, let's find all the trajectories that light will take from the camera to the light source. But there's actually a really challenging search problem.
And so basically, when the properties of the materials are non-trivial, or when the 3D local geometry of the surface of the materials is very complex, computing light paths gets even harder than what we discussed in a previous video. But computing light paths is actually only part of the challenges that are posed by light-material interactions. Computer graphics researchers first need to find clever models of such light-material interactions. In fact, one of the greatest challenges of computer graphics is
finding a general way of describing appearance. There have been many works on modeling specific types of surfaces, and there's really a great variety. If you just look around yourself, you find things that are made out of metal, out of glass. There are surfaces which are glazed that have maybe multiple layers of coating on top. There are more organic kind of substances like human skin or a piece of cake or spaghetti. It's really, the world of appearance is quite rich. And so we can go and try and build a mathematical model for one, but then that's going to be useful for that. So one interesting problem is to build a specification of a general material that can extend to many of these types of situations.
While sophisticated mathematical models have a key role to play, data about light-material interactions are also needed.
One kind of device that we've now acquired here at EPFL to help us with our work of characterizing material appearance is called a Gonia Photometer. It's a fairly big machine. It's almost 5 meters long on the long side, and it requires a room all for itself. This is quite unusual in a computer science department, where when people talk about machines, they usually mean a computer. For this machine, roughly the idea is that if you're interested in understanding the way that a certain object reflects light, you put it in the middle of this machine, and then the machine has a sensor that can observe this object from all sorts of different directions. But that's not enough. You also have to illuminate this object, of course. And so this device can also illuminate the object from any direction that you choose. This can all be controlled using motors down to a very high level of precision. And so then, if you can both illuminate and observe an object from any pair of directions, then you can completely characterize the visual behavior of the object. So that makes it possible to compare whether currently being used mathematical models are sufficient, and it also gives you ways of understanding what's really happening so that you can then go and build a model that describes a certain material in a better way. And this device will also not just be sensitive, let's say, on red, green, and blue, but it will perceive the full color spectrum and even beyond the visible spectrum. So this is quite helpful to really understand what is happening when light illuminates a particular material.
The creepiness of the Uncanny Valley is wonderfully demonstrated by John Bergeron's singing androids. Watch these videos when you're alone.
Many of the pictures that you see there of shoes or furniture, even quite large rooms that are filled with furniture, they're not photographs, they're actually renderings.